Living Seed Media brings to you God's Word, which is His comprehensive equipment for changing lives. May the Lord impact your heart as you encounter His Word. For further inquiry or counsel, contact Peace House, P.O. Box 971, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Telephone numbers 0703-036-3659, 0703-768-1198. Email address lsmedia@livingseed.org or visit our website at www.livingseed.org. Let us sit back and listen as the servant of God brings forth the word of life.
Tonight, we are now looking at the transforming message. A transformed minister bringing a transformed people. What is our instrument of that ministry? The transforming message. We want to look at what is the central message that changes men? That God must give us grace to concentrate upon. We're going to read a few passages, and I'm hoping that whatever we're able to do briefly tonight, before we break, the Lord will help us in the name of Jesus. I want us to read a couple of Bible verses. Romans chapter 1. Let's quickly go to Romans and chapter 1. Romans 1. I'd like you to please read from verse 14. Romans 1, 14. And we will read it quickly. All right. Thank you. Romans 1 from verse 14. You please get down to us up to verse 18. Romans chapter 1, 14 to 18.
I am debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. So, as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness.
Thank you. Thank you. Let's quickly go to 1 Corinthians. Let's get someone else to help us read. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Again, I will want to read from verse 17. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 from verse 17.
Lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and we bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom.
Yes.
But we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God.
25.
Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Will you please go to chapter 2? 1 Corinthians 2. You help us read verse 1, verse 2, verse 3, and verse 4. Maybe up to verse 5.
And I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you, save Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God.
Praise the Lord. One more passage before we put all this together. We're looking at the transforming message. And we need to talk with one another tonight. What is the content of the message that can bring transformation? What must we concentrate on preaching if we are going to see transformation in the lives of our people and in our ministries? What did the men of old preach that brought revival? What did they emphasize that changed people's lives? And as we are looking through this scripture, you see something very consistent, which we need to talk about together tonight. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And I would like you to help us read only verse 3, verse 4, and verse 5.
But if our gospel be hid,
yes, sir,
it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them.
Verse 5.
For we preach not ourselves,
yeah,
but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants, for Jesus' sake.
Finally, let's quickly go to Colossians chapter 1. We do that as the last verse, the last passage we are reading before we commence our discussions tonight. Colossians chapter 1. Are you in Colossians 1?
Yes.
All right. I want you to help us read from verse 25 Colossians 1 from verse 25, 26, 27, 28, 29. I think by the time you get there, we could stop.
Whereof I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God, even the mystery which has been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints, to whom God will make known what is the riches of the glory of the of these mysteries among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory.
Verse 28.
Whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Whereunto I also labor, striving according to his working, which worketh in me mightily.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I took this several passages first to give to us a panoramic view of what was the centrality of the message that turned the world upside down. The message that brings transformation. We were reading across all these different epistles because I wanted to draw your attention to something that could gradually be lost on our pulpit. And that is the reason why we could produce religious people but not converted souls. And I wish that if it were possible that the Lord will allow us to re-examine what must be the invariant in every message we preach as we are seeking the power of God to release men as you go back. The first thing I would like to note from the Roman passage that we have read, and I will need to spend a little while on that without boring you. Brother Paul came to a point of conviction. Permit me to note with you that you cannot preach a message that has not come out of your own personal conviction. You can't preach what you don't believe. Can you? Eh? Do you know that what becomes any man of God's message is usually a reflection of his convictions? And unless we are men of deep convictions on the gospel that we preach, we might not preach it powerfully. And having been in the ministry of preaching for several years, I have come to discover that when the man of God loses confidence in the message he carries, he has lost the power of preaching. So the first thing I wanted to begin to look at, what is the potency of the message that brings transformation? What's the potency of the gospel message? Where is the power of it? Now, I want you to see Brother Paul speaking very quickly. And in this case, I'm going to request, if you have other versions, to help us with. We have been reading King James. I will not mind if somebody has good news, if somebody is carrying Living Bible, or if somebody has the version they call the Message, any other version that we have, NIV, ESV, please check if you have any. You might be of help to us at this point. Now, Brother Paul said, I am debtor, both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. Why did he say he is a debtor? I want you to note that. Why was Paul declaring himself a debtor? It was because Paul came to recognize that what God has put in his heart, what God has put in his mouth, the message that God has put in his mouth is the answer to the problem of mankind. Please hear me very well. Paul recognized that what will deliver men, what will save men from their calamity, is what God has done what? Has put in his mouth. So he feels that if he meets people, if he does greet them and he did other things for them, and he did not give them the gospel that God put in his mouth, he has cheated them. He recognized that in the gospel that God has put in his mouth, that is the hope for every man he meets. He has come to know that the message of the gospel is the complete, comprehensive answer to the problem that people are running up and down with. And he can say boldly, I am coming to you people in Rome also, so that I can discharge to you something that will deliver you. Pastors, do you have confidence in what you preach? Do you believe that what God has put in your mouth has the capacity to solve people's problems? Do we believe that? Do we believe that, honestly speaking, if people can sit down and listen to what we are to preach, their problems in life will be solved? And that they don't need to go anywhere. They don't need to travel here. They don't need to travel there. They only need to hear what God has put in your mouth to say, their problem will be solved. Do you know that if you know a particular drug that once somebody uses it, it will be delivered from epilepsy? Anytime you see anybody suffering from epilepsy, what are you eager to do? You are eager to recommend and say, look, this thing, if you use it, your problem is solved. In fact, I use it on this person, I use it on this person, and their lives have changed. Go and do it. You'll be eager to introduce it because you believe in it. Am I right? Do we believe in the gospel that it will change men? That even if anybody were to have suffered from the hand of the devil, he has traveled to one Babalawo's house or the other, if he can only come to your church and allow you to declare the word of God, his problem will be solved. Do we have confidence in the gospel to that extent? Do we believe that God did not just put us on the pulpit just to be talking? That we are the ones that God has put in our hands the answer the solution to the needs of men. I want to suggest to you that, you know, sometimes when I listen to our pastors, our preachers, there was one thing I cannot but appreciate in some of our Pentecostal preachers. Even though what they are preaching may not be correct, there is something about them that I cannot ignore. What is that? They believe in what they are doing. The way they present it, they present it as if that is the end of anybody's problem. Have you noticed that? Whereas they are passionate about it because something tells them that that's the way forward. But you know, for me and you, even though you have the authentic gospel, something in your heart makes you treat it as if it's what? It's a casual message. That's the first thing that must happen to the transformed minister. The transformed minister must be convicted. He must be convinced of the potency of the message that God has put in our hands. So Brother Paul said, look, I am a debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians. You know what he mean by that? He simply said, look, whether you are a Greek, you are a philosopher, you are a doctor, you are a professor, or you are from the village, I carry something that will solve your problem. How many of you can boldly call professor and say, professor, concerning that challenge in your life, come to the Bible study on Wednesday. Sit down to the word of God, the issue will be resolved. How many of us have that boldness? Whereas the K&S, the celestial man, the mantle of fireman, he will challenge the professor and say, come for our night vigil. That problem is finished. Yosheshe adura lo magba o. O tisheshe adura lo magba o. So you see him walking up and down like this. Your church member who is a big businesswoman say, ami. Do you know what the man has done? He has otikara masiki. He has, you know, magnified what he carried. Even if there is nothing there. The people will be coming because he has magnified what he had. I want to say to you, transformation is not possible if you do not have confidence in the message that God puts in your mouth. You know what I'm praying is that as you are going from this retreat, I want you to go with boldness. I want you to go back on your pulpit as a man whom God has equipped. He has put his word in your mouth and you can pull down mountains. And by the message that God places in your mouth, we will see miracles. In the name of Jesus Christ. Paul said, so as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. For I am not, what? I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation, unto everyone that believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. Let me ask, do we have good news? Is anybody with good news? Anybody with living Bible? What do you want to read for us, sir? Eh? New Living Translation.
Good news.
Good news. Go to good news. Let's get good news first. Before we take NLT, and if I have Old Living Bible, go ahead.
Verse 16.
Yes, sir.
I have complete confidence
in
the gospel.
I have what?
Complete confidence.
Do you have complete confidence in the gospel? You see, it is important. The man of God who has experienced personal transformation, he must believe in his weapon. One of the things that has affected our own congregation over the years is that we ourselves, we are not an epitome of confidence to our members. Are you hearing me at all? If anything happens to your member and they call you, instead of coming confidently and say, look, ipa olorun ka oro olorun ta fe ka yi o ni agbara o si ye, it has capacity to end this problem. Se gbagbo dipo te so ba yen so pe we ki oluwa ki o ran wa lowo e bo le je pe iji yen nja o se le a ma gbadura die die si e je ki a gbadura je oluwa to ba je pe ife re ni oluwa jo sanu fun omo odo re ba tin ka oro re yi ibi to ba fe ki gbogbo oja si Oluwa wa gba isakoso ni oruko Jesu Oluwa wa gba te ba pare adura jan ni madam te ba de lo si odo doctor ke te mura si ya ma gbadura sugbon eyin na e kese si. Do you know what you have told the woman? You have told the people pe ko si agbara nbi yi. Now when they go somewhere else, because the man has confidence in what he carries, he says, madam, aideleku kafe oriku ba ri gbigbe a ri tutu gbogbo to sele yi ipa olorun ka efo kan bale. Bíbélì sọ wípé ohun gbogbo ni ṣíṣe fún Ọlọ́run. Eke hallelujah. Aha. Do you know that what that man has done is simply to establish that this thing I'm talking about is real. It has power. I have complete confidence in the gospel. You will not bring transformation to your people when you yourself don't have confidence in the message. The way you preach your message already reflects your faith in it or your unbelief in it. I don't know where you are getting me at all. So, brother, Eka, see, you are reading verse 16 from Good News. Yes, sir.
I have complete confidence in the gospel. It is God's power to save all who believe.
It is God's power to save everyone that believes. Yes.
First to the Jews.
Uh-huh.
And all the Gentiles.
17.
For the gospel reveals how God puts people right with himself.
Yes.
It is true faith from beginning to the end.
Mm-hmm.
The scripture says, the good person who is put right with God through faith shall live.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I have complete confidence in the gospel. I'm not ashamed of the gospel because it is God's powerful method for changing men. Where is the old living Bible before you read New Living Translation? Stand up and read for us quickly. Quickly, sir.
And that's why I can't wait to get to you in Rome.
Uh-huh.
Preaching this wonderful good news of God.
Okay.
It's news I'm most proud to proclaim.
This news, I am most proud to do what?
To proclaim it.
That's why I can't wait to get to you people in Rome.
This extraordinary message of God's powerful plan.
Why did he say it's extraordinary message?
God's powerful plan.
Mumbo. Kilo de to fi pe ni extraordinary message. Eh? O gbagbo ninu e ni. As far as it's concerned, demons of when you is not an ordinary message. Se ro pe o npanu ni. Se Paulu so npanu ni.
No.
Eh? No. Se o nso asodun ni. That is important. Be ba se pe igba yin. La ba yin pe. If you come on the pulpit lazy. If you come on the pulpit without any itara. If you are not excited about the gospel you are preaching, we don't expect excitement in the congregation. Are you hearing me? If you don't believe in what the gospel can produce, you are not likely to see the result. Nobody can see the result of his preaching more than his expectation. You know, we are talking to ourselves as pastors and preachers here. Are you hearing me? You cannot preach beyond your conviction of the message. If something in your heart say, kukuma bi o sise bi o ni sise, you can't preach it beyond that. Ejo, start again. This is why I couldn't wait to get to you at Rome. Yes, sir.
And that's why I can't wait to get to you in Rome, preaching this wonderful good news of God.
Yes, sir.
It's news I'm most proud to proclaim.
It is a news I am most proud to proclaim. Yes, sir.
This extraordinary message of God's powerful plan to rescue everyone who trusts him.
This is God's wonderful plan to rescue any man who trusts him. Yes, sir.
Starting with Jews, and then right on to everyone else.
Yes, sir.
God's way of putting people right shows up in the acts of faith.
Praise the Lord.
Eshe,
what did you read?
The message.
That's the message. That's the message. It is God's powerful method of changing men. That is what God has ordained, that anybody that come to it, whether Jew, whether Greek, could see kakawa ti irere yi ko ni gbala. That's the first thing I want to say to you tonight. The transforming message only comes from the transformed minister who has absolute, unswerving confidence in the message. If we don't believe the message, we can't preach it. Or if we are not sure of the message, if we don't know that this message, It's the only thing that God put in the mouth of Paul, and Paul made all that they did. It is the same message that Peter preached, and people were affected. It is the same message that John Wesley preached, and all of England were quaking. While we are praying for a special visitation in revival, which we are trusting God for, yet I want you to know that what God used to set the revival fire was still this message. It's nothing else. And the people that preached this message, they were fanatical about it. What did I say they were? They were fanatical about it. They were persuaded about it. So they preached it with all their strength. They preached it with every conviction within their hearts. It is the power of God for changing men. That's the first thing I'd like to note with you. What is the next thing about the transforming message that we need to take note of? I want you to see the passage in 1 Corinthians. We read 1 Corinthians chapter 1, we read chapter 2. And I was very, very deliberate about it. We are going to read a little further. But let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And, you know, we read verse 17. Verse 18. I want to spend a little time there because you know, there's a lot of time. There are many, many sermons that are preached, but that does not carry what could bring transformation to people. Many, many sermons could actually be preached in a mosque. Could they need you any kind of no? Sometimes you stand and say, these are mere ordinary moral talk. If I want Babala, one waru wasu be. That kind of message cannot bring transformation. It cannot prick the hearts until men can turn to God. So what is the message? Look at Brother Paul beginning to reset the issue for us by the grace of God. Go to verse 17. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 17 and verse 18. I want us to read it again from all the versions that is available to us. Where's my King James? King James. Verse 17, verse 18. Yes, sir.
For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel.
Is that not a problem? Did you see Brother Paul knowing? Well, Christ did not send me to do what?
To baptize.
But baptism, it's one of the ordinances of the church, and a priest ought to be doing it. But Brother Paul knew that, you see, baptism, burying the dead, naming ceremonies, thanksgiving services, marriage ordinances, housewarming, chieftaincy thanksgiving, all of these things, they are all secondary. They are not the very reason for your ordination. They are not the fulcrum. They are not the pivot of your calling. Now, why am I beginning to remind you this, sir? Unless we determine what is the centrality, what is the focus, what is the pivot of our calling. You can be in the ministry for 10 years and you are dealing with peripheral issues. You can be occupied, in fact, and that is a problem. Especially in our church, as you are growing in hierarchies, one of the first things you will see yourself dropping is the ministry of the Word of God for administration. You may see yourself very occupied with organizing this, organizing that, organizing this. And when it comes to the crux of our call, we push it aside. Brother Paul said, Eka, Ebanika, Christ.
For Christ sent me not to baptize.
Christ did not send me to baptize.
But to preach the gospel.
But to do what? To preach the gospel. Excuse me, sir. Any Sunday, there, but he was you have not served God. Ah, am I being too serious? Eh? Anytime. You may do everything else. You may greet visitors. You may shake hands with people. You may pray for Oba Yi. As good as they are not the fulcrum of your ordination. Do you know whether you are there or not? The dead will be buried. Eh? Lay reader can do that. Could they sing at your shell? But there is something that God ordained you to do, which must become your preoccupation as we go from here. It must become your emphasis as we go from this meeting. Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Yes, sir.
Not with wisdom of words.
And not with wisdom of words.
Lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect.
Go on.
For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness.
Uh-huh.
But unto us which are saved,
it is
the power of God.
All right, Eshegan. Where is NIV? Eba Milosodo Baboni NIV. Stand up and read, sir. Eshe Baba. 17 and 18.
Mary.
Eri.
For Christ did not send me to baptize.
Yes, sir.
But to preach the gospel, not with words of human wisdom, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power.
Look, God has not sent me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. And that not with words of human wisdom, lest the cross should be emptied
of his power.
Of his power. Mm. Verse 18, sir.
For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing.
Uh-huh.
But to us who are being saved,
yes, sir,
it is the power of God.
Praise the Lord. Where is the message? Go to the Baba for message.
God did not send me out to collect a following for myself, but to preach the message of what he has done, collecting a following for him.
Yes, sir.
And he did not send me to do it with a lot of fancy rhetoric of my own. Lest the powerful action at the center, Christ on the cross, be trivialized into mere words.
May God deliver me and you.
Amen.
Can I tell you something, sir? It's okay, it's okay that several of us are very educated and we have a lot of good English and we can speak very powerful rhetorics. But can I inform you? You have not been ordained to speak good English. I'm sorry. You have not been ordained. Listen. If God wanted you to be an academic expositor of oratoric speaking, it will never put you on the pulpit. It will put you among the academicians in the university. But when God located you on the pulpit and gathered souls of men to you, these are people that can go to hell. And it is not good English. They came to church to hear. We need to remind ourselves that you go on the pulpit and you meet the focus of your calling. And you are now speaking very, very fine Polish English. And you are looking for symmetries. Something, zim. And when you start on dealing with G, you start with something, G. And when you come on Shan, oh, you start dealing with something, Shan. And everyone says, you have missed your purpose. All of such only robs the cross of his power. It trivializes the cross and what Jesus did to a mere words. And if you look at your church members, most of them want a son law. Because you see, they didn't come to church to hear such things. Every time people come to church, there is only one thing that you must do to them. You must target their hearts. The heart of every man's problem is their heart. And if the cross, which is the power of God, if we obscure it in empty words, you know something? When I started going to Oyibo country to go and preach, I was intimidated that, oh, these are white people. Eh? And that I have to polish my English so that they can hear me. While I was struggling to polish English, the Holy Spirit reminded me, I did not send you here to speak English. I said, but if I don't speak Polish English, they will not understand. God said, no. These people that are sitting before you here, they are in great danger. Confront them with the word of God. Break the English the way you know how to break it. Wow. Something happened. While I was struggling, as if God wanted to remind me that, Yekoni, I finished speaking one day. Some white men came to me and said, where did you learn your English? I say, it's in Nigeria. I say, you speak so much English. We don't even understand the vocabulary you are using. I'm surprised that I have understood more English than the Englishman. The Lord said, did you hear what I'm telling you? Calm down, calm down, calm down. Face this man with the word of God. And I realized that, let me tell you the truth is this. When you focus on the message, when you focus on preaching Christ and Him crucified, you have taken men outside their strength. You are confronting them now with the power of God. The most educated of them, they will fall under your knees. The philosopher will break down because you are dealing with the wisdom of God that is stronger than the strongest of men. But sometimes, you know, you are deceived to think that just because you have returned from IMT and you have done some Master of Divinity, something wants you to demonstrate that. Larry, I want my more lodger. To pass sorrow there was not have a Greek lu. I want you to kill us, kill us, kill us, kill us, kill us, kill us. Wọ́n ló ń sọ ó ń fèdè ni wọ́n ní irú èdè wo ló tún sọ yẹn. You miss your focus of ministry when you obscure the cross in empty, high-sounding words. People like Paul, Egbomio, he was possibly more educated than us. He was highly trained under Gamaliel. He could speak Greek and speaks impeccable Hebrew. He was a man of letters. But when he understood the fulcrum, the pivot, the centrality of what God has called him to do, he said, I determined to know nothing among you. I didn't come to you with words, excellency or speech. No, that's not what I came for. Can I beg you, brothers and sisters, the message of transformation, Christ and Him crucified, we must preach it as clearly as possible. That is where the power that changes men lies. Please, don't waste any opportunity you have on the pulpit. Believe God that the power of the gospel, which is the power of the cross, will not be made empty because of the paraphernalia of trying to speak bogus English. You are no more in the Bible college. Eh? You are no more doing preaching practice. Eh? So, you are no more before your professors who are marking your presentation. You are before souls that are drowning. I pray that God will help you to see the condition of men that are sitting before you. That any of them, did you see that God just delivered us? When Baba Woshoga was telling us how one of our brothers who was supposed to be coming here was knocked off by a machine. It could have been death. Am I correct? Every soul that sits before you, they are sitting in the region of death. If your son suddenly gets will you be speaking Greek? Eh? Will you be saying shall try it to come out, try it to come out? Is that the way you'll be speaking to a boy that is drowning? Kill him, Ashe. I pray that the urgency of the condition of the souls of men will change your language of presentation. Brother Paul knew. He said, and God has not sent me to baptize. He has sent me to preach the gospel. The gospel of Christ, and not to do it with human wisdom, so that the cross, what Jesus Christ did at the cross, will not be trivialized with empty words. For the preaching of the cross, this is the next point I want you to note. Now I'm praying that I could express this so that when we go to God in prayer tonight, you will understand that as you are going back, let us fill our pulpits with undiluted preaching and teaching of the gospel. Emariato. I want you to try this. In another 6 months, you will see a turnaround. Clear. I pray that you will clear all the liturgy. Those things that may take 20 minutes, reduce it to 10 minutes if you can. To create space for what? For the word of God. You begin to teach and preach the word of God with all your passion, you will see the result. You will see the glory of God. There's no magic about it. They preach Christ and Him crucified. They did it in the plainest of language. They were highly educated, but they did not get sophisticated when it comes to preaching the gospel. Hallelujah. They could have entered into higher philosophy, but they desired to make themselves as simple as anybody could be, so that the gospel might be preached unclogged, uncontaminated, unentangled. Can I trust God that our four dioceses, by the grace of God, the fire of the gospel will break forth? Amen. I was asked to come and lead the Passion Week at the Chapel of Resurrection in Ibadan some years ago. I was going to start on the Palm Sunday, and I was going to run this meeting until Thursday before Good Friday. You know, that's a very academic society. Professors, big directors, several of them coming with their goggles. The chaplain called me as I said, Bragbile, you know, this is a very organized community. I say, I know. I was on campus before and I know these people. And he said, our service, we don't prolong it so that these people, because they are very busy people, they will not stay. I said, no problem. Just give me time to preach. So we did the procession. When I got to where they put me to sit down, my eyes was ranging. I'm looking at all these guys. I'm seeing my old professors. They're all sitting there. I'm saying, God, I have only 30 minutes. In 30 minutes, oh God, let something happen here. And I said, God, I cannot compete with scientific analysis with these people. That's not my speciality. I dare not dabble into philosophical analysis. These are great philosophers. I must not make a mistake of entry into speaking grammar and great exegesis. These people, they will show me my way out. But there is one place, oh God, where you have given me an edge over these people. The word of God. And I say, Father, in 30 minutes, oh God, before they will begin to yawn, capture them for me. I cannot tell you what happened with the Sunday service. And I desire that I don't want to start the meeting midweek. If you want to capture your church, are you hearing me? Don't start meeting midweek. There is no wisdom starting a revival meeting for your church on a Wednesday. Are you hearing me? You know that your congregation, ijo woni o wa ojo Sunday, when everybody is already rushing with all kind of ceremony. They have not been there Wednesday, they are not there Thursday, they are not there Friday, they are not there Saturday. Sunday, when they come, they are rushing. So you have wasted the week. When do I normally want to start such a revival meeting? Sunday morning. Sunday morning. When all of them are seated, that's when to capture them. Once you capture them Sunday morning, Sunday evening, they are there. Monday, they will be there. Tuesday, they will warm and rush one. So the word of God came. Let us open our Bibles to Luke chapter 15. A certain man had two sons. I saw them adjusting their goggles. Kilo first solin wele. And the junior son came to his father. Father, give me the portion of your inheritance that falls to me. And he gathered everything together and he took off his journey to a far country. By the time we started dealing with, he gathered everything. He took his journey into a far country. There, not here. Where are you? Here or there? We are not speaking English. Even if you are a primary six dropout, you know the difference between here or there. by the time the Lord had given us an utterance in 30 minutes, I said, now, bow your head and let's settle where you are. Are you there? Are you here? You cannot be here or there because you are not omnipresent. You are either in Christ or you are in crisis. And if any man say he's in Christ and he's committing sin, he's a liar. Wow. Ibe pare odake mini mini. I knew now that the Holy Spirit has come. And will I be a fisherman that will not throw a hook? As I was throwing now, I see some are removing their goggle and bringing their handkerchief, and I see them crying on their Oluwa Omaseun. I said, now, before God, who already knows your location, people think you are here. Your wife thinks that you are here, but you are not here, you are there. Where you have wasted your life in riotous living, sleeping about with students who are just like your last daughter. Professor, and you are the only one that have authority of speaking to people's life, and nobody queries you. Am I right? When I drew the altar call, they stood up. I said, now just come to this altar before the Lord your maker. He made you a prof. They were coming. They were crying. They were kneeling down. I turned to the chaplain. What do you want me to do with them? He said, just continue. I said, and as we finish this prayer, I will never, never go back to the world. Oh, so you can't go back to where you are coming from. As you are standing now, God is taking you out of that merry clay, out of that far country, and he's bringing you to himself. We are going straight to the church hall where we are going to speak more and pray. Do you know all of them went? Do you know one of my old professors who taught me quantum physics? Who used to argue about whether Christ is real or not? He was there trembling. As I'm coming to greet, Shemo Onatiwa. Oni, prof, Oni, do you know me? I said, yes, quantum physics. He said, you mean I taught you? He said, but you are becoming my teacher now. I didn't know anything. My life was actually confused. How will God help me? Now far, throughout the week, the chapel was filled. You don't need to do anything else. Preach the word. God has not called you to have money. Are you hearing me? So don't dabble into money. That is not your own currency. What is your currency? The word of God. Stay with what God has given you. That is your weapon of transformation. Brother Paul said, The Jews, they require a sign. And the Greeks, they are seeking after wisdom. That is the problem that many of us face as preachers. You may find yourself dancing to the tune of ignorant people. Don't let them dictate to you what God has put in your mouth to preach. Are you hearing me? Take responsibility for filling the pulpit with the word of God. Everything else, anybody can do it. But when it comes to the ministry of the word of God, that is your calling. And it is the ministry of the word of God that is the seed that produces the kingdom. Am I communicating with you? If we did everything in a church and the word of God is not deliberately preached, there is nothing that can change men. So why we will be calling on God in this night? Because, you know, this meeting is gradually concluding. And we must go with the message that transforms men. And I want to inform you what brought revival in those days. What we are talking about, Martin Luther, was this message. And the just shall live by faith. That was what that man began to preach. And the entire Protestantism broke forth. And Catholic Church could not stop it. They couldn't stop it because you can't stop the word of God. And I want to suggest to you, brothers and sisters, I have discovered that the only thing that will bring transformation is the same message that God has put in our mouth. Christ and Him, what? Crucified. I wish we were looking at how to handle the matter of monotony as a local pastor. That makes us to think that let's find something else to preach. Let me inform you that the message of Christ is unfading. The message of Christ can never be outdated. It can never be outmoded. It can never expire. Are you hearing me? Christ and Him crucified is fresh every day. If you decide that I will preach Christ every week, that is an inexhaustible message. And every day you preach Christ, He said, and if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto myself. Every time you present Christ unto your congregation, Christ will manifest Himself. He will manifest His power. Anytime you speak about Him, the man of Calvary who died and rose again, and you speak about His resurrection in the midst of God's people, resurrection power will attend your message. Suddenly, people will be healed. Suddenly, hopeless situations will turn. Because He said, I am the resurrection and the life. We're going to start Lent very soon. What a wonderful opportunity. Are you with me, sirs? What a wonderful 40-day opportunity. of concentrated exposition of the gospel. Do you know that if you go back now and you start telling the church that this year's Lent is a special time, we are going to encounter the man of Calvary, and the resurrection power is going to be released upon us, and every situation, because Jesus went to Calvary and he said, "It is finished." That this Lent is going to finish several issues in your family. We are starting Lent, and every blessed day of the week, God will be doing something in the sanctuary, and I'm going to be teaching the word of God. Do you know what will happen? Jemanti Oshele. Piti piti. On the church, you can fall for. Bonigba bati pegbae. Lamba shaking you. Lamba. I was listening to some of our brothers, our young men. When they want to do Holy Communion. Holy Communion that we will do every week. That our people no longer see what is the power of that sacrament. They will advertise it. Eh? They will make it look as if it's something big and say, you take communion with the man of God. And as you are entering into that communion, every covenant over your head is broken. They will be going there in thousands. And when you get there, there's nothing. It's nothing. Ordinary packaging with no content. How much will God work if those of you that have the content have confidence in what God has given us? Do you know that this Lent can become an evangelistic 40 day for you? Do you know, by the grace of God, every day you can be recording salvation and healing as we are waiting and preparing for the passion of our Lord, such that by the time we come to celebrate the resurrection, it will be such a great move of God even within your parish. But if we do not have confidence in what God has given us, if we make it look as if, well, it's just one of the church ordinances that we are trying to do, so the people come tired. They go back tired. And there is no life in it. Brother Paul said, the Jews require a sign. The Greeks seek after wisdom. Bokina Wansheo, we preach Christ crucified. Unto the Jews, what is it? A stumbling block. Unto the Greeks, foolishness. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, what is it? Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. The message of transformation is Christ and Him crucified. I want to charge you tonight as we conclude. Don't muddle it. And don't murder it. Don't empty it of its power. As I was looking at the life of Paul, I said, "Kiniwan wasu Ghana that made such a great impact in their generation?" And I went and went. I was looking for what he preached. And my research ended on the fact that they only preach Jesus and him crucified. When he came to Colossians, he said, "Whom we preach." They didn't say what we preach. In our own time, we look for topics to preach. But in their own time, what is their enduring theme? Christ and him crucified. So I found that Philip went to Samaria 3 times in the book of Acts chapter 8. The Bible said, and Philip opened his mouth and he did what? And he preached Jesus. He preached Christ. And there were miracles. I realized that men of old, they didn't preach miracles. They preached Christ. But as they were preaching Christ, signs and wonders were following them. Oluwa yo fogo re han yin. Oluwa oni misi yo misi oro re lenu yin. It will show you the manifestation of his power as you preach Christ and him crucified in the name of Jesus Christ. In that chapter 4 of 2 Corinthians, I say, we preach Christ. If we talk at all about ourselves, we talk ourselves as what? Slaves. For Jesus' sake. We preach Christ. The message that transforms men, that has transformed men from generation to generation, is the simple gospel. It's not complicated. And you know, my resolution, I resolved, because over the years, I have found that if we stay preaching Christ, number one, we cannot fade out. We cannot be outfaded. Jesus Christ is not a facade, so could he fade out? As I listen to many, many preachers all over, they're all looking for slogans. When you look at the posters they are putting, or you open the television, you just see people are just devising all kinds of things to say. Many call themselves motivational speakers. You don't know the meaning of motivational speakers. These are psychology. These are people who use psychology to psych people up. Eshe Gansa. The motivation is to do what? It to psych you up. Is to hypnotize you. That will not give us revival. It will produce rogues and wicked men. The message that brings transformation is Christ and him crucified. Will you agree with me to preach Christ? And make him plain and simple. Let me request the man that is reading message. You will now read that message for us from Colossians chapter 1. You read it very carefully in a way that we can understand. Colossians 1. You are going to help us read verse 25, 26, 27, 28. Are you reading message? I want message.
When I became a servant in this church, I experienced this suffering as a shared gift. God's way of helping me serve you, laying out the whole truth. This mystery has been kept in the dark for a long time. But now is out in the open.
It's now in the open.
God wanted everyone, not just Jews, to know this rich and glorious secret inside and out.
Inside out, yes.
Regardless of their background, regardless of their religious standing,
yes.
The mystery, in a nutshell, is just this.
The mystery. Now, this is what Paul said God ordained him to go and preach. The mystery, in a nutshell, is this. What is it?
Christ is in you. Therefore, you can look forward to sharing in God's glory.
What is this mystery? Christ in you, the hope of glory. Go ahead.
Is that simple?
It is that simple.
That is the substance of our message.
That is what? The substance of our message.
We preach Christ, warning people not to add to the message.
We preach Christ. We want people not to add to the message.
We teach in a spirit of profound common sense.
So how do we teach? In the spirit of profound common sense. Can common sense be profound? Did you hear me? Can common sense be profound? That is the secret. You don't need to sound high before you can be profound. Simplicity can be the greatest way to become a profound preacher. Go ahead, brother.
We teach in a spirit of profound common sense so that we can bring each person to maturity. To be matured.
And to be matured.
Is to be basic.
Oh my God. To be matured is to be what?
To be basic.
Is to be basic.
Christ.
Christ.
No more, no less.
Christ. No more, no less.
That's why I'm working so hard at day after day, year after year, doing my best with the energy God so generously
gives
me.
This is all that Paul did. And Asia was turned upside down. Hallelujah. This is all that Paul did. And Ephesians, Ephesus, Galatia, Thessalonica, were all overrun for God. This is what he preached, and his epistles have remained undying for these many thousands of years. Don't ever think that if you are simply preaching Christ, you'll be regarded as a simpleton. Don't think like that. Don't think people say, "Kochi e loro mi insoma." Don't let anybody intimidate you. The message that changes men, that will keep them ready for heaven, and that will bring revival to our congregation, Christ and Him crucified. Don't be intimidated by all the philosophies, all the psychological preaching that people are doing around us. Can I tell you my personal testimony? When God began to confront me and said, "The only thing to preach is Christ and Him crucified," I said, "God, will anybody come? Will I not become But I have found from my little experience that Christ and Him crucified is inexhaustible. It has drawn thousands and thousands and thousands of lives. I have found people, some I have preached, and 20 years ago they were affected. And I'm meeting them 20 years after. They say, "Orotimogboni Jonye has not left me." The word of God preached without contamination, without adulteration, has enduring capacity not to change men for a little while, but to change them permanently for all their lifetime. Can you agree with me that we will preach the message? That as we are going from this retreat, let the first thing that your churches, your parishes, what they will notice is that there is a fresh zeal to fill the pulpit with the word of God. Let us commit ourselves as we are starting this new year this way. We will preach and preach and preach Christ and Him crucified. Nothing more, nothing less. And let us see if this congregation will not be filled, running over. Some of you knew what God used in the early 70s to affect some of our lives. Some of you knew how people were trooping left and right just because there's a Bible study that they're sitting down there, they're doing nothing but Bible study. Can I beg you, do that again? You will see the youth in the community, they will be rushing there. They will be coming because the word of God is coming to them. Christ and Him crucified is the magnetic source that draws men. Nothing draws men like Christ and Him crucified. May the Lord give you courage. You know, I'm begging God to give you courage because it takes courage to be true to the gospel. It takes courage, especially in these days where we have so many charlatans who short measure the word of God for a quick advantage. Who will just carry Bible upside down and say one or two things and bulldoze the people and confuse them and collect the money in their pocket. You can be quickly intimidated and say, let's join them. Don't join them. Stay with the truth. And you will see men coming back. May the Lord help us. Shall we stand up to pray? Can we recommit ourselves to the Lord tonight and say, Oluwa, orote efisimilenu konibo, I recommit myself to the teaching and preaching of the gospel. I will be doggedly committed. Even though I will do other services of a minister, but they will remain secondary in my thinking. I will carry out all the burial, all the naming, housewarming, and all of that, if there is space. But it must not obscure my principal calling to preach the gospel. Lord, I recommit myself to the message of transformation. As we rise from this meeting, Lord, renew me. Renew me, O God, in that church where you place me. I will fill the place with the word of God. Let them say, this man, you will see a turnaround. You will see young people. They will fill that place. You will see women. You will see professionals. See how many of them are drifting from one place to another. They are hungry for the word of God. When they come to your church, give them the word. Give them the word. Give them the word. Preach the gospel. It is the power of God for changing men. Lord, I recommit myself to the fulcrum of my calling. I have been called to preach and to teach the word of God. And I will do so in the spirit of profound common sense. I will preach it with the confidence in the gospel. I believe the gospel is the power of God to change men. I will do it. Don't be beggarly when it comes to preaching the word of God. That word that God has put in your mouth is a hammer. You don't know how it works. You don't know how bones grow in the womb of a pregnant woman. God's word is living. Oni agbara, oni oro Olorun, oye, o si ni agbara. O muju ida oloju meji lo ma nguni de pinpin okan niya. E je ka gbadura pe Oluwa, I will be faithful to preaching the word. I will create space in every service for the word of God. I will create ample chance for the exposition of the truth. I will be faithful to the text of the word of God. I will preach Christ and him crucified. Please pray. Pray with me tonight. Let's pray for our dioceses. That from this retreat, there's going to be a release of the power of God as the word of God is preached. Pray that every one of you, you'll be a custodian of the message that brings transformation. Beginning from our cathedrals, the seat of archdeaconries, pray that everywhere we are going to experience a fresh outpouring of the Spirit of God. That the love for the word of God, the word for Christ and him crucified, will increase in the land. Ask God for that resolve from this meeting. That this retreat, one of the mark of it, is that the land will be filled with the truth. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. This night we trust you. That your servants are going to go forward now with the message that transforms men. Lord, we release ourselves to you in this matter. We bring ourselves back unto you in this matter. We commit ourselves, like Paul said, I determine to know nothing else among you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. With our hands lifted to God in prayer this night, let's recommit ourselves and say, Lord, the principal focus of our ordination is to preach the word. We will be instant in season and out of season. Father, renew our confidence in the word of God, in the gospel. Show us the potency of what you have put in our hands. And as we go from this meeting, oh God, we will carry the word. We will care for nothing less among men. Whether somebody is rich or poor, we will give them the word of God. Commit yourself and say, my pulpit will be a place of the exposition of the word of God. The pulpit will not be misused anymore. That every time I stand on the pulpit, it will be a place for the word of God to be made manifest in the ears of those who come. And that from this meeting, oh God, give your word expression among us and confirm your word with signs and wonders following. We put our hands in your hand tonight, oh God. We renew our covenant, our ordination to preach the word without fear, without favor, to preach Christ and him crucified. To point men to the man of Calvary. Lord, we put our hands in your hands. as you assist us, Lord, we will do so until we see your glory break forth in our dioceses and in this land altogether. Let's ask God that from this meeting, those who sit in the region of death, the light of the gospel will get to them. Those who are nominal in our midst, they will encounter Christ who went to Calvary for them. And that as we preach Christ and Him crucified, the power of resurrection will follow our ministry. Thank you, Father. Thank you for hearing our prayer tonight. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Father, we stretch forth our hands to you tonight. And we ask that you breathe upon us. Breathe upon us. The way you captivated Paul about the capacity of the gospel to change men, that made him to go everywhere. He said, woe is me if I do not preach the gospel. Let that captivating, let it capture us. Amen. Reveal to us in a very personal way from tonight the efficacy of the gospel. Amen. Lord, that as we preach Christ, Christ will appear among men. As we speak, Christ who died for our sins, who rose again according to scripture, who ascended unto heaven, and who is seated on the right hand of the Father. As we preach that Christ, the power of Christ will be made manifest among your people. Amen. Lord, in the parishes where you have placed us, beginning with all our cathedrals, all the seat of the archdeaconries, we ask, O God, that the power of the gospel will be made manifest. Amen. I'm asking, Lord, that our churches will be filled to overflowing in the name of Jesus. Amen. Complacent souls, they will be revived in the name of Jesus. Amen. As you did in Samaria, he just preached Christ, and the whole city turned. We are asking, Father, that your children will begin to experience again that outpouring, the kind you did like on Pentecost. That souls of men were crying, pricked in their heart, what shall we do to be saved? Lord, I'm asking right now, God, that men, professional women, elites in the community who will come to our church notionally, they will be arrested in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. We ask, oh God, that from this retreat, these four dioceses, we will experience a divine visitation. Amen. Lord, the word of the Lord will increase. Amen. The Bible said in those days, in the days of Eli, the word of God was scarce. But Lord, in our days, there shall be open vision. Amen. The complaint they gave in the Acts of Apostles, they said they have filled the land with their doctrine. Lord, we ask that this land will be filled with the knowledge of God. Amen. Even as waters cover the sea, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. What we see you do in Anglican Communion, it shall flow. Thank you for our bishops, oh God, whose hearts have opened and they are seeking the glory of Christ among your people. We ask tonight that you continue to empower and kindle their hearts and set them ablaze, that as they move us from one level of glory to another, this land will be filled with the word of God. Thank you for hearing us. Lord, I'm asking that you will encourage us. Encourage the least among us in the name of Jesus Christ. That anywhere they stand up to declare the word of God, you will confirm their word. you confirm their word with genuine conversions. Confirm their word with miracles. Whereas people have run here and they are going to one prayer house or the other. From this meeting, oh God, men will find solution on our altars in the name of Jesus Christ. Barren women will end their running up and down in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. Please, Lord, bring increase unto the ministry of your people. You are the Lord that said you will be fruitful and you will multiply. Make your people fruitful. Make us to multiply. You said a little will become 1,000. A small one will become a big nation. Let that promise come to pass upon the ministries of your servants in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. We know that you will do more than we can ask or imagine tonight. For we have asked in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.